Welcome back to the Help Me Rhonda Show. All right, guys, so you know how I am, right? I've been in marketing and in branding for over 15 years. And the show that I started actually back 10, 12 years ago was called the Freedompreneur Show. It was about how we became freedompreneurs, right? And the preneurship part is what I talked about. In fact, I dove so deep into marketing, into Google AdWords, copywriting, funnels, you name it. I was always tapping into like, what are the next and new strategies? And my show's developed quite a bit. So I wanted to actually start bringing it back home because most of you have been asking me, Rhonda, what is working right now? What is working right now in business? What do we do? Because the world has shifted. Well, today you are going to be so happy of the guest that I brought on. His name is Danny Carlson. He's actually the CEO and founder of Kenji ROI. He is the e-com guy, like the one that is literally cracked the code on how to build e-commerce businesses, how to scale them to 50, 100,000 plus per month, and he's growing at a rapid pace, and he's the guy some of the masters are coming to learn from. So let's go talk to Danny and see what he's been doing. Danny, welcome to the show.
Awesome. Great to be on, and I love the energy you bring every time we talk, Rhonda. So much energy.
Well, I appreciate it. You know, like they always say, when you're really doing your life's purpose, right? You get all the energy that you need. And I love this because for me, it's like I'm able to tap in and learn from so many amazing people. And you, I've been watching you. You and I have known each other for several years now. And your company has really shifted in the last, what would you say, last 12 months, you think?
Yeah, especially in the last 12 months.
Yeah.
Just because of what's been going on in the world with everything that's going on.
Yeah.
E-commerce is just taking off right now. And like everything around e-commerce, Amazon, just people are buying their stuff on the internet.
Yep. Yep. All right. So let's talk about this. Let's talk about, you are the, you know, you're the e-com guy. This is, you're what like people are needing to learn because there's so much out there right now. In fact, I just listened to this, I think it was on a podcast, they announced that GoDaddy just said that in 3 months, 1 million domains are bought. 1 million domains. Like, if you translate that into like what's actually happening, everyone is dumping online. And, you know, Russell Brunson says it so well that you're either going to be swimming in the Red Sea with everyone else, or you're swimming in the Blue Sea, right? Where your competition is irrelevant, you're unique. So how do people right now, is it too late for them to tap into Amazon and e-com? Like, how do they separate themselves from the Blue Sea, Red Sea? Like, there's so many questions I have. So at least let's start with how you got started with that. And, you know, what's your advice now for people?
Yeah, I mean, e-commerce. So first thing I want to get out of the way is, yeah, e-commerce has grown a lot in the past year. But when I first got into e-commerce back in 2015, I believe it was, people were saying exactly the same thing. It's like, is it too late to get into Amazon? Like,
really?
Did I miss the boat? Right. And looking back on that, that's ridiculous because now 2015 looks great.
I
think we're going to be doing the exact same thing in 2025, right? We're going to be looking back on 2021. It's like, if only I started back in 2021, that was the golden era of e-commerce because we're still haven't reached anywhere near full adoption of e-commerce. Yes. Like more and more people are shopping online, but there's still so much more growth to go before it's really saturated the entire retail market.
Yeah. Yeah, because e-com really, like, I've been in the information, you know, era, like, in, you know, information products, right? We've done coaching, I've done brand development. Like, everything we've done has really been generated through physical energy, if you will. Obviously, now we're into PR. But with e-com, you're working in physical products mainly? Is that what you guys are? You're working in physical products. So what right now, if someone were to say, okay, what Danny's saying, it's time to get in, like, how do they start? Like, where do you even start with your clients? Because you're teaching people how to build these stores and, like, turn them on very quickly.
Yeah, and so it really depends. Like, there's no magical formula that's going to work for every brand, every product, right? But what I always say to people is that it's better to be on Amazon than to not be on Amazon because, basically, if you look at the numbers, almost every single American at least has access to an Amazon Prime account, right?
So true,
if they don't have one open, then someone in their family does, and they, you know, their mom is buying something on Amazon on their behalf or something like that. So what you got to understand about that is that those are Amazon's customers. Those people are addicted to going and pulling out their mobile app, searching for something and having the best selection available, better than what they can find at the store for probably more competitive prices. And then they have the data, the world's biggest database of customer reviews, so they can see which product is good, which ones are not good. And then the real kicker, this is why Amazon is ahead of, you know, Walmart and those other platforms, is Prime shipping. It's guaranteed to be at their house within 48 hours, sometimes as little as 1 hour.
One day. Literally, I went back to the USA. Obviously, we've been in Bali for 6 years. I went back to the USA and I ordered a mic. It arrived in like 3 hours. I couldn't believe it. So that's where the competitive edge lies with Amazon. So you brought up a couple other platforms, and this is, I've been hearing this a lot. In fact, I was pitched by so many people. Hey, let us help you build a Walmart store. Walmart is where Amazon was 8 years ago, or 5 years ago. You need to get in on Walmart. So how can they even consider that Walmart is ever gonna compare or compete with Amazon, just given the brand awareness, right? So like what if people are asking about that? Is there like one balancing over the other?
Yeah, so I mean, Amazon has the network effect, mm-hmm. right? It's the same reason why Facebook doesn't really have any direct competitors, because everyone's on Facebook, which makes Facebook the most valuable place. And like maybe a developer creates something that's better than Facebook, but none of their friends are on there, so they don't have the network effect.
Well, it's like Clubhouse.
Same thing with Amazon,
right?
Just like Clubhouse.
Everyone's like, Ron, you need to be on Clubhouse. I'm like, none of my people are in there. Like, right? You got to go where your people are. You stay where your people are.
Exactly. So Amazon has just been spending, you know, the past 21 years reinvesting all of their profits into growing the most beautiful flywheel. So Amazon's flywheel is the more sellers that they have on there, then the more options that they have, and then the prices come down, which attracts more customers, which attracts more sellers, and it's just the flywheel that is, you know, now an unstoppable machine that it is today. So, you know, yes, there's sales volume on Walmart, but the question you want to ask is, do you want to play small, and do you want to, you know, dominate a small marketplace, or, you know, even sometimes a 1% market share on your product niche on Amazon can be more than dominating Walmart, right? Mm. And the other thing a lot of people don't think about, everyone's like, I want to expand to all the marketplaces. I want to sell on Amazon Europe. I want to sell in Australia. I want to sell here. But the problem with that is e-commerce is a very cash flow intensive business. Mm, if you're putting money to expand to all these marketplaces and these other marketplaces are turning over the inventory at 25% of the rate as your US inventory, then that's just money sitting there that you could have turned into profit much sooner and quicker. And that can really strap a lot of businesses for cash. And like, I've had a lot of friends who got themselves in cash flow trouble just because they tried to expand too quickly and didn't really realize the power of the United States market, and it's just so far ahead of everything else.
So you would recommend then, so if people are starting it, like how are you helping people select the product lines, right? Because you know, it's not about branding. Like, I'm all about brands, right? It's really not about branding when you're on Amazon, really, is it? I mean, you can start to leverage and create brands, but if people are now starting to compete with pricing, is it, like, how are they deciding which they're choosing?
Yeah, so, I mean, there's a few things to bite off there. So, I mean, of course, branding matters, right? Branding definitely matters, and there's lots of brands who do really well on Amazon with terrible listing optimization. They have one picture and, you know, few words and a title, and they still sell because they have an amazing brand and their customers who love the product, right?
Come to it, yeah, for sure.
But the flip side of that, if you're a brand new brand and no one knows who you are, then really you're just being compared against all of the other products on page one, right? Someone searches for something and they're just directly comparing you with all the other options, right? Based on your reviews, how your product looks, the features and all that kind of stuff. Amazon is a comparison shopping engine, right? So like I mentioned this before, Amazon's customers are Amazon's customers. They're not your customers. They're gonna be shopping on Amazon and they're just looking for whichever product is, you know, the best price for what they're looking for, right? So, I mean, it's a complicated question to answer, like what really sets you apart in a marketplace like that where everything is comparison? There's a few pieces to that, right? One of them is, what is the market landscape on Amazon? What are the other available options? And does it even make sense to enter that market if your product is, one, like a worse product, or two, you have to sell it at a higher price point than everyone else is selling it? You're just not going to win.
Yeah, right? Because that's really where the question is like, if someone's coming and let's say they already have a really cool product, right? Like for instance, let's just use Brian's Unstoppable Beard products. You are connected to that. You help Brian connect him to his business partner and they've been expanding upon that. And now he's got a really cool brand. Like he's in Dorsey's now and he's in all these really unique spots. But they've taken a long time to emerge into building that brand. So now they're deciding, is it time to go onto Amazon? Like, should we? Or are we gonna be placed among a billion different beard oils? And then are we gonna have to compete on pricing? So my branding mind says, no, go higher price, keep the brand strong so that everyone else is like a widget, right? They're just competing on price. Because I never want to compete on price. But is that realistic in the Amazon space? Can you still really do that and shine?
Yeah, I mean, there's lots of companies who still do have success, right? Because a lot of Amazon customers, I think I saw some data from a few years back where the average Amazon Prime customer household makes more than $100,000 a year. Wow. So it's, there's
Which
people who have money,
right? Which is a very low percentage,
right?
Of people that have, like there's I don't even know what the percentage is of that of USA, but I think the average income, like 86%, makes only like $22,000. Like something
exactly.
Ridiculous.
Right, so like the people who are buying the most stuff on Amazon
are the ones that
have
money.
People who have money,
yeah,
right?
Yeah,
like they just go on there and they think of something and they buy it because they're not worried about, you know, saving money for whatever. And it just feeds into the impulse buying, which is the danger of Amazon.
Easy, right, like how easy is it to be on your app? You're like, when I go back to the States, I'm like, I need all of these things because they
right?
come right to me. I wish we had that in Bali. That increases a bit of consumerism, which is a totally different conversation. However, you're right. Like it's like creates that impulse buy. So these people are the ones that are searching and are the ones that actually have the household income that can afford it.
Right. So, I mean, the key differentiator here is not just apples to apples on price, because there's always going to be that type of customer on Amazon who's going to buy the best thing, the most premium thing. Mm-hmm. But it's not just because the price is higher, right? There's got to be real value there. And this is something that a lot of people confuse differentiation with value, right? Like just like you look on page one of Amazon search results and you're like, okay, no one's selling an orange widget, so I'm going to sell an orange one and I'm going to be the only orange one selling on Amazon. That doesn't necessarily create value, right? Maybe no one cares about an orange one. The reason there's no orange one is because no one wants to buy an orange one. So, it's very important to actually bring value to that marketplace.
Yeah.
And it can be as simple as maybe making your product out of a different material or just fixing a very small problem with one of your competing company's products.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe they had, you know, part of the product that was unreliable and you just fixed that reliability issue. Maybe, you know, it was made out of metal one piece and like this, or the plastic kept breaking, so you made it out of metal. So it can be really simple. You don't have to go do a Kickstarter and create some totally innovative new invention. You just have to bring something that's more valuable to the customers on Amazon that they're not currently getting, and then you can charge a higher price point, and that's fine.
Okay, that's really big, actually, because you know there's always those statements that say good artists create, great artists steal, which is and make it better, which is a Picasso statement that you know most great things were never just something that freshly created. It was like a canvas that someone else made even better and embellished it and made it so much more unique, which then does lead into branding and the strategies behind how we create unique brands. So I think it's really important for people to think that way, that if there's something that's selling, it's not a bad thing to sell that too, just make it a little bit better. Right, because that's how I typically look. Like when I used to do ads, right, and I was one of the first women that made $1 million with Google ads. I worked with Perry Marshall back in 2004, and that's how I used to place my ads and the things that I would sell. I would look at who's got the most amount of ads that's selling, and I would just recreate a better copy that created more click-throughs, right? So I was selling personal development products, you know, by Procter, et cetera. And it was just like, how do I go into the market? Because if there's more fishing poles, that means there's a lot of fish, right? So that sounds like it's the same type of strategy. It's like, you just have to find where people are really buying and then just make it a little bit better, do something a bit more unique. Because I think most people try to make it so innovative that it burns their cash flow out and they can't even sell the product because they don't even know if the market wants it.
Oh, exactly. And like to cover off moral issues with copying someone's product, that's the beauty of humanity. Like, look at how complicated technology
right?
is today. Like,
yeah.
None of this stuff would be here if we didn't build
That's
on
it.
Many, many human lifetimes worth of knowledge and stuff like that. Just think
yeah.
about that for a second.
Yeah.
We're all starting off as cave people.
Right.
On every single lifetime, we'd be many,
yeah.
many lifetimes behind on our technology. But Amazon is actually not a very good platform for brand new and innovative products, for the most part.
Mm.
Just because of the way that it works, Amazon is a search intent-based shopping platform,
uh-huh.
right? So if no one knows what the product is, like actually I had a consulting call this morning with a company who they're launching a pretty new and innovative product that they told me the name of it and I didn't know what it was, right? So you can bet that not very many people are typing this phrase into Amazon looking for this product, right? So like if they are going to have an Amazon strategy, then their product needs to basically be attached to some existing search volume, something that people are typing in and looking for, they know they're shopping for. Yep. Otherwise, no one's gonna be searching for it on Amazon.
Mm. Yeah, that's really strong because you're right. That's people think that if they're entering into the market, it's just like with what I do, right, in PR, and we have combined PR and SEO, and that's why we've completely cornered the market. Then we tell our clients, like, it's really cool that we can put you in publications and do these kind of things, but if no one's searching for you or if you don't have anything that's layering that proves that that one thing that you do is good, you're like everyone else. Like, we have to create that search competition and those layers that create those keywords that allows you to be showing up as someone that's of value. And I think that's really big, you know. Let me shift a little bit. Where do you think then now, like knowing what you know now, us thinking that Amazon's been around since, how long has it been around? 2000?
It was in the late 90s.
Was it?
Yeah. They started off just selling books.
That's right.
They were a bookstore in the late 90s, yeah.
Because I was thinking like 2000, 2001, but you're right, it was in the late 90s. It was all books. Wow, I totally forgot about that. So knowing what we did then, thinking it's 2021, like, everyone's on Amazon, everything's being sold. The world just changed a lot in 2021, in 2020. And that means like 7.6 billion people in the world, 4.6 billion of them are online. They just announced like 6.2 billion are tapping in online, right? Because that's where the world is. So that means there's a lot of opportunity. However, there's a lot of competition. So the way that you're seeing the platform of the e-com space, because you said this when we started, is it time to enter into the market?
Oh, without a doubt. Without a doubt, there is so much growth happening right now in the e-com space, and so many global shifts too. Like, just one weird example of that is, so I did a presentation for a group of 500,000 Pakistani Amazon sellers and Amazon seller consultants and stuff like that. 500,000 people in this group. It is mind-boggling. Apparently Pakistan just became the third largest producer of online workers, like online export workers, just like VAs in the Philippines and stuff like that. So the interesting thing about this is you would assume that there's no one in Pakistan, you know, who's affluent and gonna be, you know, making millions of dollars and stuff like that. After doing this presentation, I've met at least five Pakistani businesses that have broke more than $1 million in sales on Amazon. And, you know, that's just from random people reaching out. Like, I'm sure there's many more of them, right? So the world is shifting a lot, and you would assume that it's only Americans and like developed countries and stuff like that, but lots of people in these developing countries are also, you know, growing 7 or 8 figure businesses on Amazon, and like India too. We've come across so many companies like that.
Well, I think it's really cool because it's almost like it's leveled the playing field, right? Like, where now anyone, if you can, they're smart people. Like, they really focus on what they want to learn and they learn it. And now it's like leveling the playing field. Anyone from any country that gets the right knowledge and the right steps and the right stages can actually do it, right? And I love that. I feel that we're like in this, like the economies of scale, it's like boom, boom, boom. The USA, like the big, here we think that we're so epic, right? There's other third world and developing countries that are completely taking over because they're actually focusing on one thing, one strategy, and they're nailing it, right? And I think this is where the world is gonna start shifting. We're gonna see like these, you know, these company or countries that are gonna start developing just because they've had time and they've had an opportunity. What do you think about that with all these other countries that are emerging?
Oh, absolutely. And so there's two ways to look at this, right? Some people look at this trend and they're like, okay, everything's getting too competitive. Yeah. Like, this is the end of an era and I missed the boat, right? There's like people from all these countries are competing for the same dollars. But another way to look at that is that all these other countries are also becoming affluent countries and they're also spending. And now we're looking at a global e-commerce market instead of just the United States being the biggest e-commerce market, right? It just raises all ships. And, you know, people in these other countries are making more money. They also have to spend that money.
And I think it's cool because it forces us to be skilled, doesn't it? Like, it really forces us. And that's one thing, you know, I've been in the online space for such a long time, and I would see these people and they were living on their, you know, their front face, right? It was like that fake it before you make it kind of style. And they would stand in front of cars and look what I've done. And all along, the ones that are working it and doing the work, right? I'm starting to see, Warren Buffett says it so well, in these times is when you see who's been swimming naked. Because when the tides go out, right? All that front face, blah, 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 look who I am. The ones that actually have done the work are the ones that are surviving and the ones that are going to be thriving. And so I love it. I love when competition hits. I love when things like that work. And which brings me actually up to a topic, because you're a super competitive guy. Like, that's, I think, part of, you know, why I really love talking with you, because we can like super banter on like what's going on. But you also, you're not just an e-com guy. You've also been a professional downhill skateboarder.
Yeah, that was a good little period of my life. Yeah, essentially, I was just living in a van and traveling to different countries around the world, Europe, Asia, United States, to compete in downhill skateboard races. So, you know, otherwise known as longboarding, just a longer skateboard with big gummy wheels. And so much fun. Usually either 4 to 6 riders at a time go down racing against each other, and then the top half of the field moves on to the next round or all the way until the finals. And it was so much fun. Honest, you know, living in the van lifestyle is not good for me long term, but honestly, I think it really
20s,
set me up
like,
well for entrepreneurship.
Like,
I've talked with a few other entrepreneurs about this actually, but I think there's a lot of correlation between extreme sports and adrenaline and just ability to, you know, be successful in business.
Yeah.
And I've met many other entrepreneurs who also had an adrenaline background, and they agree with me on this, right? Because what we face in business is sometimes some pretty crazy stuff that takes, you know, being able to push through in situations that might be scary, take large risks, and be okay with chaos, right? And all of those things are present when I'm racing downhill skateboards, right? Yeah. If I'm going, you know, the fastest I've been on my longboard is 115 kilometers an hour. If I'm going 115 kilometers an hour and there's a car coming up in the other lane and there's a corner coming up and I have to slide and there's someone right next to me and I have to try not to hit them when I'm sliding, like, that's intense, you know?
Yeah, that's like on the job, like instant decision-making process that you learn.
Exactly, you know? Right? And like, there's no room for just thinking about it and it's like, like I'll do it later. It's like, no, you do it later, you're gonna end up in the curb off the road, going flying down an embankment. Right?
Yeah, this is why I wanted to bring this correlation, because it's so big. Because I was a, you know, professional athlete. I played for the women's U.S. softball team. And I agree with you. I think that sports really, it prepares you to be an entrepreneur, because especially extreme sports. Like you said, like my husband Brian, right? He's a big wave surfer. You can't just go, oh, I think I'm going to go on this 25-foot wave. Oh, I'm not sure. No, you have to make a decision and you go with it. And I think that's what it teaches us in entrepreneurialism, is like how to make those quick decisions, but how to stay with them and even ride them out, even if they fail, right? But and learn how to make decisions that can move really quickly. And it helps us create resilience, wouldn't you think?
Oh, totally. I love that analogy too of giving up too, because it's so funny in the context of extreme sports. Right? Like, if, let's say you're hitting a giant jump on skis, you're going off this 80-foot jump, you're halfway through a backflip, and then you're like, and then halfway through your backflip, you're like, oh, I'm not sure if I can do this, like, I don't believe in myself anymore, and then you quit halfway through.
Yeah.
Guess what happens, right?
Yeah.
It's just ridiculous in that context, right? But so many people do it in the middle of their business.
Exactly. Like, why? That's the part that juices me up. I'm like, how could you be so willing to go for this, or, you know, like, you know, go for what you're enjoying, and then, but in your business, you're willing to not complete the task, and so many people quit. What would you say the rate right now of people that actually start and stop, especially in e-com? Because I bet it's pretty high, because the stakes are high and there's like a lot that goes on.
Exactly, yeah. And so, I mean, there are situations in business, of course, where you can take a massive risk and then you get yourself in a situation where maybe you do have to stop for a while for actual reasons like that, but I'd say 70, probably more than 90% of the time that people quit.
Yeah.
If they would have kept going and they would have figured it out, and maybe you lose money on your first product or something like that, but they would have figured it out after the second product, after the third product. And if they would have stuck with it for another year, another 2 years, another 3 years,
they would
have a 7 or 8 figure business.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, it's like Napoleon Hill always says in the book, Think and Grow Rich, that it's like most people are literally like 4 inches or 4 feet from gold, right? Like you're chipping away and chipping away. And that's really, I think, that 4 inches of gold. That's where all the learning happens. That's like the true entrepreneurial moments. Like it's that determination when like you have skinned your knees. You're, you know, like we lost everything. I'm holding this new baby. I got this company and I'm like, I have to sell it all, right? But it was the resilience because I could have easily taken the out. Right, and I think that's the entrepreneurship that really gets us and why success happens. And people only see the top of the iceberg. They don't see everything that's underneath it, right? All those failures. And I think that's really, that's the true juice of what makes us as entrepreneurs.
No, absolutely. You gotta be rock solid, like same as you're in the middle of that backflip and you feel the fear, you're like, I don't know if I can do this, but you commit to finishing the backflip, even though you're totally unsure if you're gonna land it, and then like maybe you crash, but maybe you just finish it and you land on your feet somehow and you're riding away with your arms in the air.
Yeah.
Right?
Right? Like, you would have pulled through it.
I made it.
And that's also that takes you, if you, that you just made me think, like that's also the mindset of an entrepreneur. Like you might think it, and it's okay to think it, but then it's like, no, I'm following through with it. See, that's the difference in those that like quit or those that they can feel it, and sometimes it does get tough. But then it's the ones that pull it through. And yeah, you might, but just because of the mindset that you had kept, you might land a little softer, right? It might be a little easier. And the next time it's going to happen again, it gets a little easier. And I think that's also, I see that often in my company, in my business, you know, like you're always going to go through this, but the wiggles do happen. But those ebb and flows get a little bit shorter, right? They get a little shorter. And they still keep happening, but it's like, deal with it, boom. And then you are like quantum leaping, opposed to like crashing and burning, starting over, right? And that's, I think that's the beauty of the resilience and you know, where we can go as entrepreneurs. I wanna ask you this before we kind of close up, because I know people are gonna start asking like where they can find you, right? And what, how they can work with you. One last question is, you know, if you were to say what you knew when you started, what would be the message you tell yourself today?
Ooh, that's a good one. What would young Danny tell Danny today? Yeah, I mean, I think I'd probably just tell myself the path that I set down is not gonna turn out the way that I think it's going to, but it's gonna end up in a really good place regardless, and just ride that wave, because the journey I set out on is different than the one that you know, the company that I started now was never the plan, you know, but it just meandered its way through there. And now we have a really great team, more than 20 full-time employees and growing really fast still. So,
wow. And so what is Kenji ROI right now? What is like the main thing that you're doing, so everyone knows exactly what you're doing and if you're the right one they should work with?
Yeah. So the Kenji ROI agency, we do Amazon listing optimization. So building the listings for brands. You know, all of the photo, listing optimization, keywords, video, and everything for a high conversion rate specifically designed for Amazon and the Amazon algorithm.
Okay.
And then we also manage the Amazon ads. And then for brands that are more existing, we help them install systems in their business that they can have repeatable ways of just launching new successful products, hiring, onboarding team members and everything like that that are set up for success, those types of things. For people who are just more interested in learning, I have a I've been putting tons and tons of resources into growing my Facebook group right now. We're doing like a bunch of lives, live guest experts in there, free trainings. We have like 30 plus hours of free course in there.
Wow.
So that's on Facebook. That's called Amazon Value Library Facebook group on Facebook.
Very cool. Okay, so Amazon Value Library, that's where they can get you inside your Facebook group. And then how can they find you any other way to learn more about, you know, the services and your high ticket programs that you run so that people can really tap in?
Yeah, so the website, kenjiroi.com, if you're looking for any of those services, that's the best place. But yeah, I mean, probably Facebook's the best if you want to get it.
Amazon to get
stuff
inside your space. I love it, Danny. Thanks for that, opening up our eyes, allowing us to really see what's happening in the world right now, and that Amazon and e-com, get in now, because it's going to be the same thought that we're probably going to have in 2025 that we had in 2015. Like it's growing, and the more and more people are coming in. And, you know, and part of my mission is helping others really see what they can do, and this freedompreneur life that we've been living for the last 15 years, no corporate, completely controlling our own economy. That's what we're able to do. And, you know, I always want to bring in the people that are trustworthy, and that those that really know you're the right one, and I know you're the real deal. So I really appreciate that so much for being here.
No, thanks for having me on.
Yeah, I appreciate it. All right, guys. Well, you heard it right from the expert's mouth, Danny Carlson is really talking about how we need to start looking at e-com, but more importantly, into Amazon, and that it isn't too late. In fact, it's the right time. And in 2025, you might be saying the exact same thing you're saying today. Oh, it's already saturated. So now get in now, because this is what happens, right? We see these economies of scale and we see industries and shifts. The world has completely changed. Normal is dead. You need to start getting out of your old operating system and start thinking now, new ideas, new ways, so that you can start leveraging this digital economy. If I wouldn't have seen and listened to what Steve Jobs said in 1998, he said, if you are not tapping into the online space and if you're not learning how to leverage it now, you will be left in the dark. I was a corporate executive back then, and in 2004, I quit my job and started learning Google Ads. I started mastering it. I got so dirty and so, you know, in the grind, but now look what we're living today. What would you give up if you knew your life could be completely different in 5 years, 10 years, maybe even only 1 year? Would you put in the effort? Would you put in the work? So I'm gonna leave you all with that. Tap right now in, make sure you go see Kenji ROI, go into the Facebook group that Danny's in. He's gonna lay lots of free content because I want you to have the absolute best education from the right people. All right, guys, another show has ended. The Help Me Rhonda Show is only here to bring you and show you and to introduce you to not only sexy brands, those that know what they do, know who they are, but they're helping people leave a bigger impact on the world and helping you create your own sovereignty so that you can also be a freedompreneur. So guys, that's the end of the show, but I always leave you with this. If you're gonna create a brand, create a sexy brand, and if you're gonna be anything, be unstoppable. We'll see you on the next show.